Dr. Mario Ramirez happens to be one of our medical consultants. He's actually an orthopedic surgeon at the Philippine Orthopedic Center. Now, he finished top of the class at the University of the Philippines. He also heads the dengue and dietary nucleotide study. He also heads the clinical study, dietary nucleotide, in children with neurodevelopmental disorders and autism. Okay, and together joining us also in the call, we have, of course, our president, Sir Leon Katz, and Dr. Arlie. Okay, without further ado, I would like to pass this now to Dr. Mario.
Thank you and welcome, everyone. I'm so excited about what I'm going to talk about right now because there are a lot of eye-opener things that I'm about to share with you guys, and hopefully you guys can understand in the standpoint how our brain is affected by our gut or how our moods are affected by what we eat. And this explains a lot of things, particularly the things I am passionate about, the effect of dietary nucleotides on patients with autism. And I have been heading the clinical study of the effect of dietary nucleotides in children with neurodevelopmental disorders and autism. And I hope you guys will understand and you guys will know what I'm talking about. But first, before anything else, I'd like to give you a short disclaimer is that the presentation herein is not intended to imply a substitute for medical advice, diagnosis, and treatment. You have to talk to your doctors, okay? All contents, including texts, graphics, images, information contained herein are only for information purposes. So this is just for you to know, but it does not the right to become mini doctors. So you still have to talk to your doctors. Before anything else, I want to show you this short video that I made.
Microbes are everywhere. On your phone, in your water bottle, on your hands before you wash them, on your hands after you wash them, and literally everywhere else on top of you too. Microbes are omnipresent at any moment, and there is nothing we can do about it. So millions of years ago, we made a pact. We give them shelter and food, and in turn, they work for us. But the more we learn about this partnership, the more it looks like a cold war. Inside our mother's womb, humans start out sterile. When we're born and traveling through the birth canal, billions of our mother's bacteria cover every single part of our bodies. This is an essential part of human health. Children born via C-section have a higher rate of asthma, immune diseases, and even leukemia. So our bodies do not only accept the invasion of microorganisms, they welcome it. Over millions of years, we co-evolved to make the best of our relationship. Mother's milk, for example, contains special sugars that are meant to feed and support certain groups of microbes, work as a decoy for others, and help to modulate the immune system. It takes up to 2 years until a healthy microbe community has formed. Every human has their own unique microbiome made up of bacteria, viruses, fungi, and other organisms. We have three categories of guests on and in our bodies. One, quiet passengers that do their own thing and are politely ignored. By being there, they take up space and keep more aggressive intruders in check. Two, guests that harm us but with whom we've learned to live. For example, bacteria that literally create acid that melts our teeth if we don't brush enough. They want to take up as much space as they can and we don't want them to. But we can't get rid of them entirely. Three, friendly fellows that our bodies want to have around. Most of them are a community of 380,000 billion bacteria from up to 5,000 different species that live in our gut. These gut microorganisms help us digest food and pull additional calories from things we can't digest ourselves. Unfortunately, our gut is also the perfect point of attack for intruders, so it's guarded by an aggressive army, our immune system. To survive here, our microbiome co-evolved with us to be able to communicate with our body. The most important part of that is to ask the immune system to not kill them. But they also have a real motivation to keep our gut healthy, so some of them produce messenger substances that help to educate the immune system, and others stimulate the gut cells to regenerate faster. But over the last few years, evidence has emerged that the influence of our gut microbiome goes much, much further. It might even talk directly to our brain. We've observed a few curious things. 90% of our body's serotonin, an important messenger substance for nerve cells, is produced in the gut. Some scientists think the microbiome does this to communicate with the vagus nerve, the information highway of our nervous system. Other examples are bacteria that stimulate immune cells in the gut, so they send a kind of alarm signal to the brain. Here, it activates immune cells that help the brain recover from injuries. Since the brain decides when we eat, the microbiome is interested in a healthy brain. A new field of science is opening up here, and we're just on the verge of understanding how these complex systems inside our bodies interact. But we are starting to see how much our microbiome actually influences us and our behavior. Take depression, for example. Healthy rats fed microbes from the guts of depressed people began showing anxiety-like behavior and symptoms that look like depression. And in early 2017, a study linked the microbiome to intelligence by connecting a certain setup of bacteria in newborns with better motor and language skills. But it might also influence our daily lives. Tests with fruit flies showed that their microbiome influenced what kinds of food they craved. This could mean your microbes are able to tell your brain which food it should get them, although this is not a one-way street. The seed for our microbiome comes from our mother, but how it develops and changes is determined by what we eat. The organisms in our gut feed on different things. Some like fibers and leafy greens, others go for sugars and starches, and some love greasy fries and butter. Our gut is like a garden in which we constantly decide what will grow and blossom. If we eat healthily, we breed bacteria that like healthy food. If we eat a lot of fast food, then we breed fast food loving bacteria. Life is hard, so we can get trapped in a vicious circle. You have a stressful time and eat lots of burgers and fries and pizza. This is awesome for fast food bacteria. They multiply and multiply and take up space from vegetable-loving bacteria. But even worse, they send signals to the brain to continue what it's doing. This makes you want more fast food, which breeds more fast food bacteria, which makes you crave fast food, and so on. This kind of self-reinforcing cycle could play a huge role in obesity. But it's important to stress that you can fight this process and reverse it by eating healthily and breeding more good bacteria. Beyond weight gain, our microbiome has also been linked to other serious diseases like autism, schizophrenia, and cancer. One of the earliest symptoms of Parkinson's is actually gut problems. If your body is overrun with bacteria that harm you, there is often only one solution. You bring in an army of good guys. That's very easy. You just transplant some healthy poop. You do that by literally transferring poop from a healthy person into your gut. This method is already used to cure diarrhea that's caused when C. difficile bacteria take over a gut microbiome. But we just don't know enough about the complex interplay at work here yet. For example, a transplant from an overweight donor cured a woman's diarrhea, but contributed to her obesity down the line. This caused some waves, and another study tried to reverse the effect. Poop transplants from slim people to obese ones gave them a more diverse microbiome and made them less sensitive to insulin, both things that also happen when people lose weight. We need to do a lot more science to really understand how our microbes make us healthy or sick. But whether we like it or not, we need our microbiome and it needs us. We'll never have our bodies to ourselves, but we have gained a powerful ally, if we can just keep the peace.
I found a lot of things interesting in this video. I mean, quite a lot of eye openers. Number one is that 90%, I didn't know about this, but 90% of your serotonin is manufactured in your gut. Your happy hormone is being manufactured in the gut. So if the gut is no gut, no good, then you're going to have some problems. And as you can see, that the gut science, which is the study of the gut microbiome, okay, and how it affects your brain, you can see the prominent gut microbiome in different areas of the gastrointestinal tract. The most you can see is here in the colon, the small and large colon. And they serve specific purposes, and they serve specific and causes some specific responses in your brain. And this is the reason why it's important for you to understand how our food, our supplements, our diet is responsible for our brain and how we feel. Okay, so we go on, and this kind of connection between the brain and the gut is considered to be the brain, which is considered to be the central nervous system, and the little brain, which is your gut, is called the enteric nervous system. So there are two nervous systems in the body: the brain, the central nervous system, and the enteric nervous system. And it contains, like, the enteric nervous system contains more than 100 million nerve cell endings that lines the intestinal, the gastrointestinal tract from your esophagus to your rectum. And this provides us with a lot of information, and the connection between the enteric nervous system, your first brain and your second brain, seems to be, although the enteric nervous system seems to be not capable of thought, but your second brain can affect your first brain, how it thinks and how it evolves. This is according to Jay Pasricka, the director for the John Hopkins Medical Center for Neurogastroenterology. So the two brain talks. One brain talks to the second brain, and the second brain talks to the first brain, and will tell you how this brain affects each other. So your gut, therefore, affects your mood, and how your mood is affected by your gut. And your mood also affects your gut, and your gut affects your mood. So it's a two-way bidirectional flow, wherein the link between the intestinal microbiota and your central nervous system grows and grows, and this is called the gut-brain axis. And I hope after listening to this lecture, you put more importance on what you feed your gut. There is a condition that is called dysbiosis. Dysbiosis means an imbalance in the gut microsystem, the gut microbiota, and it could lead to both inflammatory or intestinal problems, as well as extra-intestinal problems such as metabolic syndromes, diabetes, obesity. And this dysbiosis is also linked to some and most neurological problems like Alzheimer's, Parkinsonism, autism, multiple sclerosis. And the imbalance of your gut microbiome has a lot of effect on the general health of the body, like hypertension, multiple sclerosis, aging, atherosclerosis, diabetes, obesity, autoimmune disease, cancer, liver problems, metabolic problems. All these because of an imbalance in your gut. This only serves to strengthen and stress the importance of how the gut microbiota affects the brain. So not only does it exert the effect on the brain, not only through the nervous system, that is through the anatomical pathways of the gut brain, but it also affects through the immune, endocrine, and metabolic system. Most of the gut affects through the vagus nerve, through your autonomic nervous system, which is your vagus nerve, but it also affects through the immune system, the endocrine system, the metabolic systems, and this affects you in terms of producing stress, sleep disorders, and problems with your general health. Now, how can gut microbiota affect your brain? It is, like I said earlier, affected through the vagus nerve. The vagus nerve is an autonomic nervous system, autonomic nerve, and it communicates bidirectionally to the brain. That means the brain sends signals through the vagus nerve, through your gastrointestinal tract, through your enteric nervous system, and the enteric nervous system sends signals through the vagus nerve to the brain. So it's bidirectional. It's a two-way flow. It's a two-way traffic. And 20% of the vagus nerve sends instructions from the brain to the stomach, while 80% of the vagus nerve sends instructions from the stomach to your brain. So what does the brain send to your stomach? It sends signals for gastric acid secretion, enzyme secretion, digestive enzyme secretion, gastric capacity, which gives you the feeling of satiety, blood glucose levels. Well, the other thing is that the vagus nerve sends signal, hunger signal to the brain, tells you, oh, I'm hungry, I need to eat. It also gives you sense of fullness, gives satiety levels and energy metabolism. It tells you why you need to burn and you need to do more things, more involving energy. It also gives signals that when you feel like, for example, you've eaten a lot of carbohydrates, of sugar, you feel the need to go to sleep. The brain tells you the brain basically shuts down. And what is happening is that you need to sleep. You feel sleepy because of too much food that you have eaten. So this is how the effect of the brain occurs. And how does the gut microbiota affect your brain? Through the signals of the vagus nerve that may induce either an anti-inflammatory in response, prevent infection, prevent inflammatory states that is otherwise caused by pathologic microorganisms. Like the microbes, for example, can produce neurotransmitters like serotonin, signal the brain via the vagus nerve and keep you happy. Gut microbe can also stimulate your immune cells and produce cytokines that travel through the brain via the blood vessels, the circulation, and stimulate brain cells to produce more immune system cells to fight either a brain infection or a generalized body infection. Gut microbes also produce metabolites that travel through the brain and stimulate gut epithelial cells to produce neurotransmitters that could activate the vagus nerve. All these can show that the gut-brain axis is an integral part of the body's ability, particularly of the brain, to influence your intestinal microbiota, and the ability of your intestinal microbiota to influence your brain and gut behavior. So it is important that the gut microbiota be stressed in the development of the neuroendocrine system, particularly that influencing the brain, because your gut bacteria can synthesize components like butyric acid, dopamine, serotonin, short-chain fatty acids, which influence the brain, and the brain can influence the gut microbiota. Gut microbiota, or the gut microbiome, has a propensity to affect the neural circuits, and which is related to the stress response, particularly producing ammonia or lactic acid, which are neurotoxins and can affect the different parts of the body, like your gastrointestinal tract and your smooth muscles, like your the muscles of the nerves. So there are myriads of neural influences that involves the gut microbiota and the brain. So the complication and the involvement of the brain and the gut is a two-way bidirectional flow, and it influences the gut axis, like the brain can influence motility, secretion of digestive enzymes, nutrient delivery, microbial balance, okay, while the microbiota can influence neurotransmitters, stress, anxiety, mood, and behavior. And all these can be shown as scientists discover more and more a connection between the neurodevelopmental degenerative disorders like Alzheimer's, Parkinsonism, gut microbiome disorder. So there's a connection. Moreover, there's a stress that manganese, for example, is a toxin which causes some environmentally linked Parkinson's disease. So metal toxicity with manganese can influence gut mobility and subsequently produce a key microbial metabolite in the gut that can affect your brain and cause some Parkinson's disease or the development of Parkinson's disease. Therefore, it is likely that the exposure to toxins, heavy metals in food, the environment, can cause a change or a shift in the gut microbiome, producing unfavorable effects. With the shift of the gut microbiome to bad bacteria, there is a production of unfavorable effects in the central nervous system in your brain. That explains why sometimes a lot of the things that we are eating can cause some problems. So let me show you and share with you some of the clinical studies, and I hope you guys can understand. These are third-party clinical studies, and I want to share with you. But first, let me show you there is a gut microbiota according to the Physiological Review published in 2019. And the gut-brain axis, therefore, is a new field for investigating biological and physiological, psychiatric, neurodevelopmental, age-related, and neurodegenerative disorders. The gut microbiota, for example, and the brain communicates with each other by various routes, like the immune system route, the tryptophan metabolism, vagus nerve, autonomic nervous system, the enteric nervous system, the involvement of gut metabolites, such as short-chain fatty acid, branched amino acids, and peptidoglycans, which all affects the gut and at the same time affects the brain. So in this abstract, they said that there are many factors that influences the gut microbiota, particularly early in age. And let me stress with you, the mode of delivery shows that there, saw from the video, the mode of delivery influenced your gut and your exposure to microbiome, the beneficial bacteria that our body needs, as well as the use of antibiotics. There are a lot of prevalence use of antibiotics has caused a lot of problems in the gut. The provision, the not nutritional provisions, environmental stressors, and host genetics also play important factors. Gut microbial diversity decreases with aging, meaning you produce less good bacteria when you age, and this affects your gut-brain axis, which affects the brain and causes a lot of problems such as Alzheimer's, Parkinsonism, schizophrenia, anxiety, autism, senile dementia. Now, when you get older, you can see that your brain or you remember less. And this is because of the diminishing of the gut. So according to the Journal of Neuroendocrinology in 2019, shows the role of the gut microbiota in development and function of the central nervous system. According to the abstract, the gut microbiota has emerged as an environmental factor that modulates both the central and the enteric nervous system. Before obtaining its own microbiota, the fetus, the baby, is exposed to products that metabolize from the maternal microbiota, meaning as you undergo normal spontaneous delivery at birth, you are colonized by your maternal microorganisms. So you are exposed to your mother's microorganism. And this mother's microorganism early in life is influenced by the mode of delivery, such as you are less exposed to the mother's microbial composition when you undergo cesarean sections. And there is therefore a direct link that shows that the gut microbiome can modulate important process, particularly in developmental problems and the development of children after birth, including neurogenesis or nerve development, myelination of the nerve sheaths, glial cell functions, synaptic pruning, blood-brain barrier permeability. All this is affected by the gut microbiome. So this is one study. We go on to the next study. And according to another journal of physiology, the gut instinct, microbiota that influence the key regulator of brain development and aging and neurodevelopmental degeneration, you can see that in this study that points out that your gut microbiome will affect your brain development early on in children. It affects your aging process. It affects neurodegeneration that leads to premature Alzheimer's, senile dementia, Parkinsonism, a lot of brain problems. And according to the abstract, is that there is a growing realization of this gut-brain axis. And it is worth knowing that, again, according to the mode of delivery, your mode of delivery sometimes affects definitely your gut microbiome, because Caesarian section said distinctly different microbiota early in life as were compared to those that were delivered by normal spontaneous delivery. So now we go on to the use of dietary nucleotides in gut studies and biodiversity in your body. And let me show you some of the studies that we have. I have found. Okay, again, let me point out the disclaimer that the presentation is not intended to be a substitute for professional medical advice, diagnosis, treatment. All contents herein, including the text and information, are just for general information purposes. So let me stress is that there is the gut signaling has been studied. And according to Dr. Clara Kobelkova and Alice Marcello visited us and showed us the effects of how nutrition can affect your gut microbiome. And in essence, when your gut microbiome is affected, your brain is affected, your health, general health is affected, and everything else is affected. In this study by Dr. Clara Kobelkova and Alice Marcella, which tells us this. It's an original study that was published in the Military Medical Science Letters in 2020, just recently. So you know this study, and you know this slide. These are the slides of four groups wherein rats were fed the controlled studies. These are the control with regular fluid, water, and A and B is the controlled. Whereas the C and D are rats who were fed with immunogen treated mice. Okay, these are with an immunogen treated diet, and you can see the ileal growth and how big the ileal capacity of itch. This is the ileum, your ileal villi, and you can see how the ileal villi had grown tremendously from the control to your immunogen treated mice. And this study has shown that there are a lot more important things going on, because again, let me stress, as I have told you earlier, that the communication between the gut, that microvilli, and your brain passes through the ileal villi. Okay, the villi, this where the communication goes in through the vagus nerve to the autonomic nervous system, from the autonomic nervous system to the brain. And the better the communication, the better your gut microbiome, the better the communication, the better the communication, the more information you can get. So in conclusion, what they said in this slide is that the data collected from the experiment with the oral application of Immunogen as a drinking regimen and a control study, that Immunogen modulates the Bacteroides firmicutes ratio in favor of the Bacteroides genera, which means the good microbiome is actually enhanced compared to Firmicutes, which is the bad microbiome. So Immunogen also said, according to the study, Immunogen also causes no pathological changes in the intestinal microepithelium. And the further dysbiosis, wherein there is the dysbiosis, Immunogen can reverse the situation of dysbiosis that had changed in favor of the bad bacteria by producing more of the good bacteria, which is the Bacteroides species. And this is according to, again, Dr. Clara Kovilkova and Alice Marcella. They presented this during the recent doctor's conference at Shangri-La here in the Philippines. Emergen and chronic stress is that Emergen can produce the bacteroides, the best significantly increased, while the Clostridium, which is the bad bacteria, is decreased significantly. In chronic stress, it's the other way around. The bacteroides is decreased, while the Clostridium, the bad bacteria, is increased. And again, why Emergen in people with chronic stress? Number one, it is an amino acid-rich nutrient. Number two, Emergen can modulate the psychological well-being of people because it increases, like I showed you earlier, it increases the serotonin levels because the good bacteria is actually enticed by Emergen by producing more serotonin levels, therefore producing the happy hormone effect that you get when you take a lot of Emergen. And Emergen acts against changes in the microbiome, which is induced by stresses. So, and let me share with you this video, the short video, before we end up things.
How the gut and the brain communicate has fascinated us for centuries. The gut-brain axis transforms information via the vagus nerve from food to feelings. Once eaten, digested food particles enter the small intestine, which is covered with a velvety layer of villi. Each villus is lined with a single layer of epithelium. This layer is made up of different cell types. One of them, the enteroendocrine cell, is unlike the others. It is our gut sensor. In addition to communicating through hormones, we discovered that enteroendocrine cells also synapse with nerves, including the vagus nerve. We call those enteroendocrine cells synapsing with nerves neuropod cells. They sense and react to their environment. They sense mechanical, thermal, and chemical stimuli, such as nutrients or bacterial byproducts in the gut lumen. Inside neuropod cells, signals from stimuli are converted into tiny electrical pulses. These pulses propagate via synapses onto the afferent neuron of the vagus nerve. Vagal neurons carry the sensory information to the brainstem, linking the signals generated inside the small intestine to the brain. The neuropod cell connection with the vagus nerve serves as a conduit for food in the gut to influence brain function within seconds. This connection is also a potential portal for gut pathogens to access the brain. This new knowledge is a foundation for designing therapies to treat disorders related to altered gut-brain signaling.
We have now modalities that could help change the environment on how on your gut, particularly the microbiome in the gut and how it affects the villi. So a happy gut means a happy brain, a happy mind, and happy you means a happy and healthier gut again. I hope this explains a lot of things and the general bidirectional flow of gut information. And I want you to end. I want to show you a world premiere of my video, okay? How it affects your feel-good video. I hope you like this.
Wow! I feel good. I knew that I would not. I feel good. I knew that I would not. So good. So good. I got a year.
All right, guys, thank you.
I feel good.
Thank you so much.